So this is the SR latch, which I've talked about in a previous video, and I'd encourage going back and looking at that video if you're unfamiliar with it. But basically, the latch has two inputs, R for reset, and then S for set. And when the reset goes high, then the output Q goes off, is reset. And then when the set pin goes high, then the output Q goes on. And then there's also an inverted Q, which is always the opposite of Q. Except for one case where if both reset and set inputs are high, then both of these go off. And that's generally considered an invalid setting, because you shouldn't be both setting it and resetting it at the same time. And in fact, if I then release both of these, it's kind of arbitrary which one comes on, because whichever one of these I'm releasing first kind of wins. But generally, yeah, the latch is going to latch in one of these two states. So in this video, what I want to do is talk about some modifications to this simple SR latch circuit. So the first thing I want to look at is the SR latch with an enable. So this is the basic SR latch that we just saw. But now we've got, on both of the inputs, we have these AND gates that are connected to an enable signal. And basically what that does is, if this enable signal is high, if it's a 1, then these AND gates pass through whatever the other input is. So if this is a 1 and reset is 1, then it passes through a 1. If this is a 1 and reset's a 0, it passes through a 0. If the enable is 0, then the output is always going to be 0. And so the latch, if enable is 0, the latch always stays latched in its last state. And so this just gives us a way to enable the latch, in which case it's going to pay attention to its two inputs, or disable it, in which case it just stays latched regardless of what happens to these inputs. So it's just a slight modification of the basic SR latch. We could take this a step further and turn this into a flip-flop. And the difference between the SR latch and the SR flip-flop is, and in general, the difference between a latch and a flip-flop is that a latch, the outputs will change whenever the inputs change. With a flip-flop, the outputs are only going to change when there's a clock pulse. And so a flip-flop's always going to have some sort of clock input, and in the diagram for it, the clock is indicated by this little triangle signal here. And so then whenever the clock pulse comes in, or specifically when the clock transitions from low to high, in this case, then the outputs will change, and only at that transition point will the outputs change based on whatever the inputs are at that point. The rest of the time, it doesn't matter what's going on with the inputs. And so the way that works is, we have this clock pulse coming in, and it's, you know, when it transitions from low to high, when this voltage changes here, you're going to get some current flowing through this capacitor as the capacitor charges. And so over here, you're going to see the voltage go up as soon as this transition takes place. But then, once the capacitor charges, that voltage will drop, current will stop flowing once the capacitor is fully charged. And so this clock pulse, no matter how long this clock pulse is going to essentially show up over here on the inputs to these AND gates as this really quick pulse just at the point where that rising edge happens. And so that very quick pulse is used to essentially enable, if we think of what we saw before, the SR latch with the enable, it is essentially what's happening over here. And so that SR latch with enable is only enabled just at that moment where the clock rising edge happens. And so that has the effect of it working like an SR flip-flop. So when the clock rising edge happens, then it looks at the R and S just at that moment where the clock rising edge is. And if reset is enabled and set is not, then it resets. So the output goes to 0 and the complement of the output goes to 1. If the clock rising edge happens and at that moment the set input is active and the reset is not active, then the output Q turns on and the complement of Q goes off. And then if there's a clock rising edge and both the reset and set inputs are 0, then it just stays in the last state. It stays, you know, latched like it normally would. And in any other case, no matter if the clock is not, if there's not a rising edge of the clock, if the clock is doing anything else, then it doesn't matter what the set and reset is doing. The flip-flop stays in its last state. Now there's one interesting case here, which is where if you have a clock rising edge and reset and set are both active, remember this is that invalid state. So if reset and set are both active, you know, we saw before with just the SR latch, if both inputs are active, you see both the Q and the Q complement go off. And so you might expect that, right? Q and Q complement go off. But the reality is that when we release both of these, a latch does settle down in some state. And that's actually going to happen here too. One of these two inputs is going to you know, be slightly ahead of the others, and the SR flip-flop is going to settle down into some state. So we really aren't actually going to have this output case where both Q and Q invert are both zeros. I mean, that's invalid, right? Because you would assume that the inverse of Q would be the inverse of Q. You would not expect it to be the same thing. And in fact, that's true. And the problem is with this this situation where you have both a set and a reset when you have a clock pulse, it will settle down into some state, but we don't know what it is. So really, these are both kind of unknown what'll happen. So this is, again, kind of an invalid situation where we don't really know what's going to happen here, because it just depends which of these is a few nanoseconds faster. You know, it's unpredictable. But there is something we can do to make that a little bit more predictable, and that is the JK flip-flop. And so the JK flip-flop is very similar to the SR flip-flop, except that it has this feedback coming from the outputs. And so it has these three input AND gates over here, and it's looking at the current state of the output Q and Q inverse in determining what's going to happen on the input. And as far as I know, you know, JK is just kind of an arbitrary set of letters. It doesn't mean anything. But I guess this is different enough from an SR flip-flop that they gave it a different name. But anyway, if we walk through what's going to happen here, you'll see it's very similar. So if J and K are both zero, then it doesn't matter what else is going on. The output of these AND gates are both zero. And so we have this same situation where, you know, even if we get a clock pulse, we're going to stay in the last state. But now let's imagine a case where the latch is currently set. So Q is 1, inverse of Q would be 0, and we want to reset it. So if Q is 1, then this is going to be 1. And if we want to reset it, then we're going to set K to 1. So this input will be 1 because, you know, the current output is 1. It's currently set. K will be 1 if we want to reset it. And then when we get our clock pulse, this AND gate will turn on, and this will be our reset signal. And that'll reset the latch and turn Q off, and then, of course, inverse Q on. And so that's this scenario here, where J is 0, K is 1 to reset it, and then we get our clock pulse, and so you see Q goes low. We reset the latch. But what if the latch was already reset? So if the latch was already reset, then Q is already low, and we set K high, and basically this stays off. And, of course, J is also low, so this stays off. So we have both zeros, and so we stay in the last state. But that's okay, right? Because if we wanted to reset it, we're setting K high to reset it, and it was already reset, then it's fine to leave it in the last state, right? It was already reset, and we want to reset it, leave it in the last state. So that works fine. And same thing in the opposite case. So if it's currently reset, so Q is low and inverse Q is high, then that means this is high. And so if it's currently reset, and we want to set it with the J, then both of these inputs will be high. And then when we get our clock pulse, this input will go high, or this output of the AND gate will go high, and we'll reset the latch. And so you can see in these cases, it works basically the same way as the SR flip-flop. It's just that we have the inputs are called J and K instead of S and R. So where the JK flip-flop gets interesting is if both J and K are 1. Because in that case, because you've got this feedback here, J and K are both 1, but these other two signals, these feedback, are not going to be both 1, right? Because either Q or not Q is going to be high at any point in time. You're not going to have both of them high, right? So if Q is high, then this lower AND gate will be active, and the top one will be off, right? You know, even if J and K are both 1. If inverse of Q is active, then the top AND gate would be on, and the bottom one would be off. So what this does is it means if the latch is currently set, then effectively what's going to happen is this lower AND gate is going to come on and the latch will reset at the next clock pulse. Whereas if the latch is currently reset, then the top AND gate would be on and the latch would then set at the next clock pulse. I mean, assuming J and K are both 1. And so that gives you this very interesting state where instead of getting some invalid or unpredictable output, you get this very predictable output, which is it'll just toggle. So if Q was 0, it'll switch to 1. If Q was 1, it'll switch to 0. And as you'll see, that's a very interesting property.